This program is made possible in part by the WKNO Partners in Excellence Fund, committed to presenting quality programming, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
A lot of them come to us, and what they discover is a haven. What they discover when they come to us is a group of people who care about them.
We call it specialty care here, right? Okay, that's what we call it. We don't say HIV care. You are our VIP patients, all right? You really are. You don't have to make appointments through the phone system. You can call her, she'll make your appointments for you. If you ever can't get us and you need to come in and see the doctor, just show up.
And care about them regardless of their income or their lifestyle and regardless of their personal circumstance.
So much of my judgment depends on my own interaction at the time, but I try to show her, like, do you see this pattern and what do you think about it?
Most recently, you've been betrayed again by a young man who you are forced to see every day, both in your work and your home environment, who is probably still involved with at least one other woman who you know. But your bowels are acting up and you've lost weight. Let's throw in there that you have literally had the finest and most absolutely complete evaluation of your gastrointestinal tract that I've ever seen in 20 years. Sometimes the light kind of comes on. I'm not saying you're crazy, okay, or that you're faking. I try to come back again and again to try to show her something. But, oh my gosh, if I were you, I would have all of what you have and more. Do you want to come live with my family? Because I can't think, I mean, 201 Poplar to me is a better choice than what you're doing now.
You have to know, for your particular clientele, what questions are the most important questions to get across and what things are affecting them and what barriers they're dealing with.
Have you had any surgeries at all, any operations
in your life? No, I just got a bullet in the chest.
We do what we do because we're called to convey the love of Christ in all of our encounters.
Over and over again, they do things that are well beyond what their job describes. And I think that's because they've come here with a greater purpose and a greater calling. It's not just about a job of working in a health center. It's about, you know, the name of Christ, I say, is the first name of our first word on our name. It says Christ Community Health Services on our building, and that's for a purpose.
I think each of us had an idea about being a doctor, wanting to do something a little different.
We were looking for a place that we felt that God was calling us to.
The broad outline of the idea was working together to serve the neediest people we could find in the name of Jesus.
There wasn't much in the way of medical care left in the South Third area when we looked.
On the face of it, this would appear to be the story of four doctors who graduated from LSU in the early 90s.
Well, when we first came, we thought we had a deal set up. One of the hospitals was going to build a clinic for us, and we were just going to come in and do what we wanted to do. But then, of course, as soon as we got here, that fell through.
Or it's the story of how an idealistic dream had a near head-on collision with the kitchen sink reality of the healthcare business.
We had some people who would say, listen, you're kind of an idiot, and that's not going to work ever, and you should just think of something else.
And, you know, it was a little frustrating, and people would say, oh, that sounds great, we'll get back with you in a week, and of course, that would be the last you'd hear.
And I'm not sure which I liked better. You know, I think probably I'd rather have the people just flat out try to discourage me than to sort of encourage me but not help me.
And we ended up working in the emergency department at the Med for a couple of years.
Well, I come to know the two of them through the Med Hospital because I actually grew up in the Whitehaven neighborhood, which is the 38109 zip code, so I knew the families there, some of the struggles and the difficulties.
It was a difficult time, and I think, honestly, David Pepperman is the one that kept us at it because there were several times where I despaired. I just didn't know if it would happen. And he was really the anchor and the faithful person.
But as they'll tell you, the real story is about a group of doctors whose faith made them understand that God was in the driver's seat, and they really didn't need to take no for an answer.
At the same time, we felt like if we kept doing what we thought God had called us to do, that whatever happened would happen, and so we didn't get too stressed about it, and it always worked out, so we felt like we must be on the right track.
And there have been times where we've had to call fasts and had special times of prayer to get through disastrous times.
And I, you know, I'm not an administrator, so I wasn't hands-on with the money problems, but I remember discussing them, and I remember praying about them.
It seemed like any time we had a need, it was met.
But I don't really think that they realized what was all needed. You know, at the time that we started, we needed a lot.
It was better than a donation, to be honest with you. What Baptist Healthcare Foundation did for us is they went to the bank and they co-signed a line of credit for us, and for $400,000, which was, at that time, 15 years ago, enough to get that first clinic open.
And I remember when we all had to co-sign the line of credit and thinking, wow, we've actually got some money.
The agreement was, if you guys are still, your head's still above water 12 months into this, then we'll pay down half of that line of credit, $200,000 grant. And yeah, it would not have happened if Baptist hadn't stepped in.
And also St. Francis, and well, we wouldn't have made it if it wasn't for all the help we received along the way.
We couldn't have planned it any better. I mean, if we had tried to figure out solutions to these problems.
When we finally got our plans together and we're actually at the point of trying to staff the clinic, Robbie was somebody we knew well, we'd worked with, and we asked her to come over. And it was a no small act of faith on her part to do that, I think.
So I walked into the door and it was empty. We didn't have any like examining tables.
We actually got most of our equipment from a physician who had shut down his practice and had stored it up on the second floor of a building. My only recollection is going up and down stairs many times, David and I and Steve just carrying exam tables, and in the van we'd rented ourselves. And
we did end up in a little strip mall where on one side there was DHS department, on the other side there was a large skating rink.
At first I don't think they noticed us, to be honest. We were just this little clinic there.
So we tried to just get word out, and yeah, one day we cooked hot dogs out front.
We say they were low-fat hot dogs, but they were hot dogs to people just to, you know, draw interest.
We were checking blood pressures and doing free glucose screenings.
Handed out flyers.
We hit nearly every church in that area, gas stations, beauty shops. We put posters up, billboards. We tried advertising.
Get involved in some health fairs and kind of letting people know that we were there. It was probably fortunate that we did start out slow, because the patients who came to see us were very difficult, had a lot of medical problems that hadn't been addressed for a long time, and so it was good we could spend more time and attention starting out.
Today, South Third has grown into a facility that has its own pharmacy. The staff of doctors and nurse practitioners have increased, and they have to deal with new challenges, such as the growing immigrant population in Memphis.
Where's our language line number? You stopped taking your blood pressure medicine. Was it giving you problems?
I lost weight and I don't have any problem. I don't take it anymore.
Okay.
The dental office has also been an important addition to the South Third Clinic.
In many ways, the oral health needs of the poor and the people we serve are greater than the medical needs. So today we have grown from a couple of dentists to soon to be six dentists.
Robbie Jones left for a few years, but now she's back at South Third.
When I returned coming back here, I knew the Christ community was still involved in doing what they do, but I did not know that we had grown to the capacity that we had grown.
She knows firsthand how the needs of some patients can pose some unique and challenging problems.
You came in because you needed a pregnancy test, correct?
No, I know I'm pregnant. The lady that I went to, that gave me the ultrasound, she was like, something wrong with one of my babies because it won't move.
Okay. Did they tell you how far along you were?
2 months.
2 months. Have you been feeling like baby movement at all?
You can't tell.
I have an 18-year-old female that has twins, and she was told that one of the twins did not have a heartbeat. Her due date, she told me by ultrasound, was the 24th of August. There is some risk involved, like I said, you know, if you're in your first trimester or if you're in your second trimester, and so that's why we need to get your ultrasound quick. I also need you guys to call over to Broad. I already talked to Dr. Amberson, but let the front desk know that she's going to be seen there by Dr. Amberson.
Now
she's on her way there now. And I'm going to call Dr. Amberson myself and tell her that she's on her way too.
In spite of the initial scare,
all right, maybe we'll save a baby today.
It was found later that both babies were doing fine.
You're rolling about here, man. Y'all get to own some this one, y'all.
Okay, sorry.
On this particular day, one of Peppermint's patients has some special concerns. He's a man who was caught in some crossfire and shot in the back over a decade ago. The wound left him paralyzed for life. Recently, his wheelchair broke, and he had to borrow one to make the appointment. He's also been experiencing depression.
Do you have any interest in me trying to ask the social worker if there's other people in a similar situation that you could get together with and kind of share the frustrations?
That does sound good.
Let me see if there is something like that. Do you notice a lot of swelling at the end of the day? Or?
Not too much, because I still do my own therapy, Doc.
Good. Nothing particular is giving you a lot of trouble?
No, sir.
Good. Just lean forward. And you're not getting any bed sores, nothing's breaking down.
And this wheelchair here it ain't meant for me to be sitting in it. So with me like being a little bit heavier and my wheelchair is down, it's causing me to stay inside the house.
Well, it shouldn't take as long a time as it took.
But last time.
Yeah, it totally won't take near that time. We start writing and come back for you in just a second.
That's a good doctor right there. Yeah, we care about the patient.
The man tells our photographer that he fell victim to yet another shooting incident back in 2009.
I was coming down real slow. When I heard that doom, I stopped for a second. Then something started burning my leg, so I got to looking down and man, I'm shot. So I rolled around, turned around and looked. I don't see nobody in the alley. You see?
In one way or another, Dr. David Pepperman will always be tied to the clinic at South Third. He spends his time in other clinics, to be sure, but he spent years tending to the needs of these patients, and nobody knows them better.
And these spots, too, have been just recent?
But Dr. Pepperman, he takes time out, and usually with me, I have a little problem with kind of expressing myself, a little shyness of myself, but... Mm-hmm. He takes time out and he allows you to just go into every detail and then he tries to work it out with you.
I'm going to send you up to the referral person with a few different tests that we might look at.
The next real step was to go to Binghamton and to open what is our Broad Avenue Health Center. And we did that. We did that with the sponsorship and the financial support of the Assisi Foundation.
To live in a place that is different than what I'm used to, and I grew up as a middle-class American, and that's the world I've always seen. There's been a lot that living in the community has done for me to understand my patient population better, but also to understand myself better, and to understand we're really not that different, but at the same time, we do see things from a different perspective. Okay, what does it mean to live like Christ every day of my life? What does it mean to be Christ in the day-to-day living of a hard place as opposed to my little insulated world that I used to live in?
A lot of my patients are also my neighbors, which just gives you an extra connection. You can be in the room and you can say, hey, I live two blocks away from you. She's like, oh, we're neighbors.
Hey, Dr. Weaver.
I saw, especially Joe, just connecting better with the patients and seeming to enjoy the practice more.
Hi, how are ya? Dr. Weaver, good to see ya.
And frankly, I started to stalk him. I would just drive back through Binghamton on my way home and just drop in, hey Joe, how we doing? And I really began to envy what I saw he was doing. I live in Binghamton and have since 2003.
On this night, Rick Donlin opens his home for Passover, playing host to colleagues from the clinic, as well as his African immigrant neighbors, some of whom are also his patients.
The Jewish people
including Jesus, we're going to talk about in a second, have been following basically the same pattern for 3,000 years. So
it's this kind of cross-cultural experience and fellowship which is at the core of Christ Community's philosophy.
Why on this night do we eat especially bitter herbs?
It has also helped Donlin in his day-to-day work as a doctor.
There's plenty of things I regret, you know, because I'm an idiot sometimes. My character isn't what I wish it would be. But I don't regret what I've done with the medicine that I've learned. Like, I don't think I'm going to wake up 10 years from now and say, oh, what the heck? Why did I waste my time doing that, you know? I feel like that was one decision and some stuttering obedience that I'm never going to regret.
Okay, what you got?
She's a 30-year-old woman, history of hypertension, with a vast amount of complaints today.
Okay, so what do you make of this? There is a chlamydia and a gonorrhea test that's negative. Negative chlamydia and gonorrhea. HIV testing, that she's been tested for those things 6 times in the last year and a half. Because actually this is, you're gonna be an obstetrician. I mean, you'll see this, right? Like, what's at the bottom of that? Because most 30-year-old women don't have a big fat chart like this. I'm Dr. Donlin. I've done lots of circumcision. I'm gonna ask you to wait because you don't wanna be in here when we do it. I don't want you to think it's necessary for your son's health. All right, you sure you wanna do it? Okay. We call it sharpening his pencil. But it's not absolutely necessary, just so you know that. You got the scissors, Mary?
Yeah, they're in the pickup, so we have scissors.
Just a pair of sharp scissors.
Okay.
At some point or another, he's going to try to pee on us. It's good to have it there. All right, my friend. This was Mom's idea.
Understanding the culture of the neighborhoods has also informed some of the decisions about what kind of care to offer patients. One example is prenatal care. This hasn't always been easy from a business standpoint.
Out of that, we recommitted and we decided, okay, it doesn't matter how hard or how difficult this is. It doesn't matter that it's hard to make the economics of it work. We're going to continue to offer prenatal care. And out of that, it has grown to be the single largest service that we have at Christ Community.
The process is ongoing, and different methods are being tried at other clinics. But with the opening of a new clinic in a new neighborhood, the general needs of patients are constantly changing.
I grew up 40 years in this neighborhood. My role models were just the men on the street want to be like them. I had a problem with drugs for quite a while.
That was my crack house right there. Right there.
I found Christ and he delivered me from all the substance abuse and now he used me as a tool. I know they have made an impact simply because people around here have little money. If they don't have any medical treatment, things go untreated, and this becomes a major problem.
I'd heard a lot about Christ Community during my residency training. I'd heard about their working in the inner city, working with the refugee population, HIV patients, all that. Sort of these, what we'll call the forgotten or the isolated groups of people who aren't otherwise cared for.
All right, let's see here. This is technically your first visit, isn't it? So, other question I get a lot too is AIDS. You don't have AIDS, okay? AIDS means that your CD4 count is below 200. That's when it's called AIDS. Or if you have other infections, which you don't have, okay? So this is just HIV, and hopefully we'll never have AIDS. And most of our visits are going to be us talking about stuff. For me, what's most important is that you understand what's going on with your virus, understand what's going on with your body. And so 20 years ago, HIV was a death sentence. It wasn't a matter of, you know, am I going to die? It was a matter of when am I going to die? Now, it is an illness as of right now, 2010, March 24th. All right, there's no cure for HIV. Right. We don't have a cure, but we can get as close to a cure now without as you can get. There are medicines now that work that will drive the virus so far into remission in your blood that when I check a drop of blood for the virus, I can't find it.
I think that there are a number of young physicians who this exposure has altered their trajectory, that We've had some people change specialties.
So I'm trained in family medicine only, but since here I've become sort of the HIV specialist here at Orange Mound. I haven't done any extra training in HIV, but just the sheer volume of HIV that we see here in Orange Mound, I'm the only person who does it here. I've learned on the fly.
I'm really glad he came back in. Yeah. I was really concerned that he wasn't going to come back. Because at first, when he first found out, he was, I'm just going to forget it.
They tell me over and over again that Christ Community is this place where they know they can come. They know they can show up here. I had one of my other patients that that was recovering from drug and alcohol addiction, and he was doing great for about 6 months and then relapsed and did some cocaine, and he showed up. He walked here, and he showed up, and he said, I didn't know what to do. I didn't know where to go, and so I knew I had to go see y'all. And so he said, I knew that y'all could help me, and that even though I'd messed up, that y'all would make it all right. And we, you know, and that's what he came here for. He came here for hope. He had hope nowhere else. He couldn't call his family. He knew that the place he was living wouldn't take him back in because he had been doing drugs. And he said, I knew the only place I could find hope was coming to Christ Community. And he walked several miles to get here and he just showed up.
If the clinics have become havens of hope, the desire is to build on that philosophy at each new location.
Our expansions have just largely been like the first. We try to identify the neediest places and we, you know, the next site was Fraser. And there was almost no primary care available in Fraser.
We got a lot of experience, we gained the strength, we understood more about the diversity of Memphis, and that when you've seen one neighborhood in Memphis, you've seen one neighborhood in Memphis. It's a mistake to think that all communities and neighborhoods are the same.
How are you feeling?
Yeah.
The demand has also brought Christ Community to a growing population that can no longer be ignored.
Well, can you tell her thank you for going to med number one?
Le quiero agradecer que haya ido al hospital ayer. Muchas gracias.
That means that we can start here and try to find out what the cause for pain is. There's been a lack of care for them in the past. They've had care, but it's been in other countries, in Mexico or wherever they were coming from.
When she had this happen in Mexico, they told us due to the high blood pressure she was having.
And they come here and they're here for years, 2 or 3 years, and they don't have any kind of care. So they come in here with problems just like what you've heard. I've had problems with blood pressure before. I've had problems with my heart before, but I've neglected them for 3 or 4 years, and so we're trying to catch up.
So it doesn't hurt to move your foot. Does it hurt to put pressure?
Yeah.
It's tender in there.
Mm-hmm.
For Dr. David Pepperman, God's larger plan isn't just limited to the clinics here in Memphis.
As a clinic, we had started seeing refugees fairly early on at Third Street Clinic and became involved in praying for certain unreached countries, and so we had prayed for Afghanistan for quite a while, and then actually started taking some trips over there, and it was long before 9/11.
It's the same calling that brought physicians and nurses from Christ Community to Haiti earlier this year.
It was hard to drive through that city and not understand that every single person in Haiti was affected by the earthquake.
Just driving along, riding on top of a car, and we were talking, and then suddenly I started paying attention to what was going on around me and stopped and really had nothing to say, couldn't talk. At the National Mansion, where the president lives, you see pictures, it doesn't do it justice, it's just crumbled.
And I think coming back, like the two words that I used were intense and overwhelming.
Everywhere you look, there's just destruction. And thinking, you know, here's a collapsed building. There are people underneath that rubble now.
When I'm trying to walk in to go to my house, I saw many people die.
A lot of people we'd ask about their story, just tell us their story. What happened on the day of the quake?
Many accidents, motorcycle, cars, truck, because there's so many dust, nobody can see. Nobody knows exactly where we're going because of too much dust. So I didn't have no faith. So When I saw my family come out to this house, I says, oh, God is real.
The fact of just doing simple routine primary care was something they don't have, and they may not have it for months because the devastation was so complete, you know. A whole generation of physicians and nurses and medical staff are gone because the schools are wiped out.
Has this always been like this here?
You have to be willing to put yourself out there and to deal with the fact that it's overwhelming and to deal with the fact that you're not going to be able to deal with all the needs. You can only do with what you have right then, and you can take care of the person in the now.
It's already healed. It's been 6 weeks. Yeah. It's probably rehealed that way, and it'll slowly absorb. I just wanted to
make it. I was just amazed by the way that they responded to the situation. Very resilient, I would say, very joyful. They all had headaches and stomach aches, and so the biggest problem really is a headache from dehydration and a stomach ache from no food.
Okay, so take this card over to the pharmacy and they will give you some vitamins and other things.
Compassion and hope, setting the example of Christ. As long as there is an unmet need, sometimes on a foreign shore or on a daily basis right here in our backyard, Christ's community will always be at the forefront.
This program is made possible in part by the WKNO Partners in Excellence Fund, committed to presenting quality programming, and by viewers like you. Thank you.